Good evening and welcome to another edition of Tigers Roar right here on Pelican Sports TV. I'm Tommy Chrisan, glad to have you tuned in to the program this week. It's August. August is here. That means football, football, football. Everywhere I've been in the Baton Rouge area this week and around South Louisiana, everybody's just talking about football, whether it's prep, college, pro. And, of course, we got the lockout is over. College, LSU's reporting this week and beginning practice. High school's not far from getting away. But we got Tigers Roar for you. We want you to spread the roar. It's every Wednesday night at 8 o'clock, Baton Rouge, Lafayette, and New Orleans, coming at you live on Wednesday nights at 8 o'clock, two-hour program. Now, we do have a lot of replays that occur, not just on Pelican Sports TV, but some other outlets and some other stations around the state and on the Mississippi Gulf Coast. So if you're catching this on Thursday, Friday, or Saturday, you got a little replay going. But it's going to be live on Wednesday nights. As we get closer to the season, we'll have a segment where we can take your phone calls, get your questions or comments and your thoughts, all that good stuff. Also, Pelican Sports TV will have a post-game show immediately following LSU football for all 12 games, home or away, including that Thursday night game in Starkville, Mississippi. So we'll have that. And we got more details, a couple little changes on the post-game show we'll tell you about when we get a little bit closer to that LSU Oregon kickoff on September the 3rd in Arlington. So it's Tigers Roar, and I'm joined by NFL scout and Fox Sports football analyst Chris Landry. Chris, how you doing?
I'm doing well. Football season, you can smell it in the air. It's here.
It's here. It's hot. It's plenty hot. And, of course, South Louisiana been getting pounded by rain as of late, but football's ready to go. The rain's not going to stop football.
No, it's not. And, of course, it's good to get the rain, but then get the rain out of here because a lot of the high schools in the area need to get their work done. It's tough for them to deal with all this rain. But certainly with LSU reporting, they've got the indoor facility. But getting some good quality work outside is what they want to do. And so the weather is turning for the positive, so that's a good thing.
And for those of you that may be a little bit new to Tigers Roar, by the way, this is show number 50, so tip of the hat to the crew here at Pelican Sports TV as we sit here for the 50th time in a row doing this, and that's kind of cool, but this is primarily LSU football, Tigers Roar. It began in August of 2010, right before the season last year, and 90-95% of what you're going to get is LSU football, whether that's recruiting, player information, interviews with Coach Les Miles and players that we'll capture at Media Day each and every week, comments from the stadium. I mean, you're going to get a lot of LSU football. Certainly, as when the fall semester goes forward, when basketball gets around, we'll mix in some basketball. And as we like to say, I run through the athletic department at LSU, where you'll get some tidbits on the other programs and the other coaches and student athletes that, you know, be it golf, be it tennis, be it track and field, whatever it might be. We're going to focus on that. And with Pelican Sports TV airing in Baton Rouge, Lafayette, and New Orleans, there will be occasion when we'll mention Louisiana Lafayette's Raging Cajuns, who are also reporting this week. Coach Mark Hudspeth was a guest on Tigers Roar earlier this spring. First-year coach, he's trying to create some excitement in Lafayette, and I think he's doing it. I've heard that he's really hit the streets hard in Lafayette and trying to build that community to support his football programs. The Raging Cajuns are trying to improve and get better. And, of course, being in New Orleans, we'll have mentions of Tulane, and you know, in the spring we'll talk Delgado Community College baseball and basketball. So, you know, it's a little bit of all of South Louisiana, but again, the primary focus is LSU football, LSU sports, and then we mix in all the rest of the stuff for you. Now, when you're not on the TV, we got radio for you. Each day, Monday through Friday, I should say, from 3 to 4 p.m., it's Pelican Sports Radio with Chris Landry and me, Tommy Chrisan, on the Score 1210 a.m. in Baton Rouge, the score1210.com. It's streamed, so all your friends and family around the South Louisiana, around the country, around the world can get it on the internet, and that's Monday through Fridays from 3 to 4 p.m. And then Chris Landry has his own show on Thursdays from 2 to 3 p.m., same station, the Score 1210 a.m. in Baton Rouge, and online, score1210.com. Podcasts are available later tonight, both of those shows at the score1210.com. So the Chris Landry Show, where it's football, football, football. And Chris, give everybody a hint of what you'll have on the Chris Landry Show this week. And then after you give the hint, I got a little announcement.
Okay, great. Well, I'm looking forward to that. In the football breakdown segment, we'll break down LSU special teams. You know, special teams are often overlooked. We're going to talk about the importance and kind of break down the different skill sets and of all the different players on the LSU special teams unit, and give you a scouting report on the coaching staff. What their strengths and weaknesses, what are their roles? We'll kind of get through that in Football 101. We're going to explain how a wide receiver goes through his reads post-snap. So we'll do that, and we've got the latest football scoop. And what we're going to do is start to give us the names of some teams that may be a little bit off the radar in college football this year, not the big-time programs, but are going to have good years. And then the rest of the story that we always like to end the show with, sometimes comical, sometimes inspirational. This one's going to be about the one that got away from me, got away from LSU, and is on his way to the Hall of Fame, Pro Football Hall of Fame this weekend. So we hope you join us on the show.
And a special announcement we have for you pertaining to the Chris Landry Show is beginning this week, this Friday, in New Orleans at 6 p.m., there'll be a rebroadcast of the Chris Landry Show on WIST, 690 a.m., 104.9 FM on your dial in New Orleans. Each Friday at 6 p.m., you'll be able to hear the Chris Landry Show as it was recorded on Thursday, so it'll still be plenty fresh, and yeah, it might be a nugget or two that gets out of there because of the delay, but we appreciate Dan Frazier and his staff at WIST Radio in New Orleans as we worked out a partnership and an agreement there. You'll see some promotions of IST. They will promote Tigers Roar and Pelican Sports Radio and Pelican Sports TV and the post-game show and all that stuff. So we'll keep you posted on that. We'll tell you about that each week as the fall goes along as well. A great way to keep up with Pelican Sports TV is go to Facebook. Pelican Broadcasting is the Facebook page. Keep up with all the information. An easy way to contact us, we have a YouTube page which has lots of features that we run here on Tigers Roar and other stuff that the staff here does. The Twitter account at Pelican Sports, you can keep up with us, find out what's going on. And as always, send an email to pelicanbroadcasting@gmail.com. We'll get it to the correct person. Whether you got a show question, a topic, an idea, something you saw that you like, something you saw you didn't like, it doesn't matter. We'll get it to the necessary people and get you a response. pelicanbroadcasting@gmail.com. Just fire it away, whatever you do. And we appreciate the many people that do send us some information. So when we come back, we got an LSU basketball topic to talk to you about. We'll get into fall practice and some roster news for you with LSU football. Again, they're reporting this week on Wednesday, starting practice on Thursday. And we got a lot of football for you tonight, a whole lot of football. He's Chris Landry, NFL scout, Fox Sports football analyst. I'm Tommy Chrysan, and you are watching Pelican Sports TV, Baton Rouge, Lafayette, and New Orleans.
I'm Bruce Mitchell, and you're watching Pelican Sports TV.
40 years, 4 decades, nearly half a century. That's how long the citizens of Greater Baton Rouge have chosen Richards Honda. A simple, sincere, and honest process.
Louisiana's oldest and most experienced Honda dealership for over 40 years, Richards Honda.
Either you can say real meat or you can't. And at Papa John's, the reason we call our sausage is because it's 100% real meat. Nobody does what Papa John's does.
Introducing Papa's Summer Special. For just $10, get a large spicy Italian specialty pizza loaded with pepperoni and double the spicy sausage. Or get any large pizza with your choice of toppings, even specialties, only $11. Order now at the new PapaJohns.com.
Better ingredients, better pizza. Papa John's.
Attention all companies dealing with cash flow problems. Companies are going out of business every day. Bankruptcies are at an all-time high. Accounts receivable delinquencies are at the highest levels in decades. Let us help your business collect money owed to your business. NRH and Associates has the solutions. Let NRH and Associates utilize their innovative collection methods to get cash flow back into your business. Call 601-889-0501. That number again, 601-889-0501.
You know, on the same flight.
We'll be on the same flight, regardless.
Yeah, what we should do work. Anything together? Do we know that?
Got it.
Thanks, Dave.
The big, brilliant, thin Samsung Infuse 4G. Only from the network of possibilities, AT&T.
Pelican Sports TV presents Pelican Radio. Get ready to mix it up with me, Tommy Chrysan, and Chris Landry weekday afternoons from 3 to 4 p.m. Pro sports, college sports, high school sports, and much more on The Score 1210 AM and on the internet at thescore1210.com.
40 years, 4 decades, nearly half a century. That's how long the citizens of Greater Baton Rouge have chosen Richards Honda. A simple, sincere, and honest process.
Louisiana's oldest and most experienced Honda dealership for over 40 years, Richards Honda.
We continue with Tigers Roar TV, Baton Rouge, Lafayette, New Orleans on Pelican Sports TV, Wednesday nights, 8 p.m. You're catching us Thursday, Friday, Saturday. You got a little replay going. We appreciate you. And spread the roar. We're going to be here every Wednesday, all football season long and throughout the whole course of the year. As I mentioned, this is show number 50 for Tigers Roar, and it's a tip of the hat to the entire Pelican Sports TV crew. You know, Chris and I get to sit here, but a lot of people go into making this show what it is, including all of you who take the time to view it and tell your friends and family about it, so we appreciate that a whole lot. As we said, it's football, but we're going to open up with a basketball topic, if you will, as some news came out this week that outstanding high school player Ricardo Gathers from Riverside Academy down in Reserve, Louisiana, has committed to coach Steve Lavin and the St. John's Redmen. Are they Redmen anymore?
The Red Storm.
Red Storm. They changed their name. I should have knew that, right? And this was somebody Trent Johnson was recruiting heavily, somebody who's considered to be one of the top prospects in the country. He'll be a senior this coming fall. He's coached by Timmy Bird, who's a former LSU quarterback, and Timmy actually backed up Alan Risher at LSU before going over to Southern Miss and threw a few balls to a guy named Lewis Lips, and they had a pretty good combo in Hattiesburg over there. So Timmy has done a great job for a long time as a high school basketball coach, and it's only a verbal commitment at the time, and we all know the commitment versus signing story. But this was not good news for Coach Trent Johnson and the men's basketball program at LSU.
Well, you know, Ricardo's certainly an elite player. You know, he can play the small forward, the power forward. He's got great skills, considered the best basketball prospect in the state of Louisiana. And basketball coaches around the country consider him one of the best in the country, a difference maker, and considered a must-get for Trent Johnson. And as you mentioned, a lot of emphasis was put by Trent and his staff on getting him to, for him to go to a hot program, and that's what I think I would classify St. John's. We know historically under Coach Luke Kornacek and the great run in 1985 when they made the Final Four, they've kind of fallen on hard times, a number of different coaches, but Steve Lavin, known for as a great recruiter, had the number one recruiting class in the country last year, and obviously off to a good start this year, getting a commitment from Ricardo. As you mentioned, you know, verbal commitments, it's not a signing, but doesn't look good. I think a lot went into the decision, and apparently he's headed towards the Big Apple, into the big city, if you will. So tough loss, and you know, you wonder, and as we get closer to basketball season, we'll deal with it. But you know, it's good, it's such an important season. We know Johnny O'Brien's going to have an impact, probably start as a true freshman, going to need to, but no commitments in the class of 2012. A bad season with the news of not being able to get the top player in state is not a good start to what is the precursor to beginning of basketball season in mid-October.
You know, and breaking that down a little further, you know, he's going to, you know, looks like he'll leave the state. You know, LSU's not going to get everybody, but you would want him to get the top guys. Now, if you're an Ole Miss or a Mississippi State fan, you could be saying, well, Johnny O'Brien from Cleveland, Mississippi, why didn't we get him? Why did he go to Baton Rouge? You know, so it happens, and some of the better players in LSU history weren't from the state of Louisiana, you know, when they were recruiting him. But in the landscape as it exists now, I think, you know, when you look back at what John Brady did with getting Big Baby Davis and Tasman Mitchell and Garrett Temple and, you know, the Brandon Bass and Tyrus Thomas, the list goes on and on. He was getting all those players, and Thomas wasn't the top player when they signed him, but he was getting all those big names. And, you know, Trent Johnson, if there's a knock to be had on Trent Johnson, it's the recruiting portfolio that he has assembled is not shiny at all.
Well, you're right. It's some great points you bring up. The bottom line is the production on the court hasn't been what it needs to be. Now, all of this will go away and be quieted to some degree if there's a much improved season next year. The issue is, how is it going to be much improved? I mean, you look at the incoming of Johnny O'Brien, John Isaac as a shooting guard, Anthony Hickey, a point guard from Kentucky. Will they make an appreciable difference on this year's basketball team? Time will tell. It probably will need to be. I know that patience is wearing thin, because when you don't have a big-time player and you're not able to get someone that was considered a must-get, it is difficult. For someone that maybe has had more success on the court, you know, could you miss a guy here? That you're right. You're going to miss some of them. But this is tough. This is a tough loss. I was hoping at least for LSU that they were able to get him. And we'll see. We'll move on. But he's a great player. Wish him the best. And now, you know, you look at the kid from St. Aug, the Felix kid who's a point guard that, you know, I don't know how much of his decision is going to be predicated on the fact that they signed Anthony Hickey from last year. So, you know, certainly recruiting is the lifeblood, and it's fallen a little bit short. We'll see how it translates on the court this fall and then next spring.
Let's roll to a couple of football notes for you. First off, as you know, LSU only has 6 home football games on the 2011 schedule. There will be 8 on the 2012 schedule, 8 home games, I should say. And it was announced this week that the final piece of that 12-game schedule, 8 home games, Towson State. Okay, they're from Western Maryland. Their nickname's Tigers, by the way. And they will be coming to Baton Rouge. They went 1-10 in the football championship subdivision last year. And I know it's going to create a stir on Pelican Sports Radio. And, you know, all the shows on the Score 12:10 a.m., I'm sure are going to be talking about it like crazy. But, Chris, like I told you earlier today, Towson State? I mean, come on. But might have been the only option.
Well, here's what happens when, you know, and certainly it's a result of Les not being happy with playing the North Carolinas and Oregons and the bigger schools. And if you are going to make a change in your philosophy, if you choose to do it in a very swift fashion, you end up not being, because schools make their schedules several years in advance, you're almost better off kind of gravitating towards it and not making any drastic changes. Then you probably could get a mid-major, maybe a non-BCS type school, but a good quality school that you can bring in. But when it's hard to schedule and everybody's locked up for a few years and you're trying to make that change as swiftly as they are and add that extra game, it's very difficult. You've got some people that might want to play, but on that certain date, it's difficult. So you end up having to go this route. And yeah, that's tough. I've been to that program, know the guy that coached over there, and they've struggled a little bit, as you mentioned. Good basketball program.
Yeah, they went to the NCAA tournament a couple of times as of late. And but the only thing I'll say about that, and we'll move on, is that'll keep Tiger Vision alive in 2012 because no one will pick up that game at all. Okay, football. Some roster notes for you, roster news, if you will. Chris, you've got some information that has just come down this
week. Well, you know, obviously as they open up, and of course players are reporting on Wednesday, so Thursday is the first practice. So Wednesday's orientation, everybody getting together. There's a 105-man roster that has been established by the coaching staff. By the way, Russell Shepherd is on that roster and is expected to practice in first practice, but according to the coaches. There is no official word from LSU administratively, but that's the plan there. So we'll see how that plays out on Thursday morning. Mickey Johnson, of course, from St. Paul's High School in Covington, still not completely cleared academically. They asked him in May, or they told him in May, that they would probably like to get him to gray shirt, which puts him in next year's class and takes him off of this 2011 recruiting class numbers. That's probably what's going to end up happening. Alonzo Lewis, a receiver from St. James, is probably going to end up going to junior college. So that is an issue with numbers. If Mickey were to get cleared academically and they decided to add him to the roster and redshirt him, which is more than likely the possibility that they would do, then they'd be won over. It means another player on that roster would have to go. But that's the way it's looking right now, that Mickey will end up being gray-shirted, be part of the class of 2012, and Alonzo Lewis will end up going to junior college. So that's kind of the updates there. And, you know, what's going to be interesting to see as we start, it's real interesting how, you know, you report on Wednesday. In the morning you have meetings, you have all the orientation stuff. And to get a feel for, give folks a feel for it, Tommy, you get your schedule layout, you check into West Campus Apartments. Then the afternoon you have medical physicals, and it's like a conveyor line. You have all the doctors and trainers and everybody go through the different stations, and then they go through the equipment part of it. Everybody gets fitted for their mouthpiece. It's not just a generic one. It's actually impressions like you take when you go to the dentist or orthodontist, and those are made. That all gets done in the afternoon, and then obviously more meetings, and then on Thursday morning, players will be out. Veterans will have the first practice. In the afternoon, some selected veterans along with some freshmen are going to practice. And that's kind of how the schedule is going to go. They're going to have split squad workouts for the first 2 days on Thursday and Friday. And then the third and fourth days, you're going to add shoulder pads to it. So it's a gradual process. You work them in. You like to get the young guys some reps, TK, before their head starts to spin a little bit. Some of them have already been in the program in the spring, but it's a nice easing in process. You're really working on fundamentals, your installation of your system. You're getting that in place because as you turn to, we're going to fast forward now to Sunday, August 28th, where you're going to meet with your team and prepare Monday practice for Oregon Week. So everything you want to get done to really work on your stuff. And then internally as coaches, you're putting some things in ready for Oregon, but then you start to introduce that in Oregon Week like you normally do in any other normal week.
Yeah, so we'll have to see how that goes as they get ready for Oregon. Like you said on the radio, you don't want to start preparation for Oregon too early. You can saturate the kids. It can become mundane. It can become, and then you got to time out the whole mental thing too. Where,
absolutely.
Where they're peaking and then they're tapering and then they peak at kickoff, correct?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you deal with this.
I mean mentally, not physically.
Absolutely. You deal with it on bye weeks, too. You start, you got extra time. Well, you just can do more, right? Well, yeah, you do more. And then what ends up happening is you peak about Wednesday or Thursday of game week, which is not. You want to get your team to be peaked on Saturday in college and Sunday in the NFL, of course. So how you go about that is really important. You want to introduce things. And there are things you can do subtly to get your team prepared without introducing that this is something we're going to do against Oregon or do against Mississippi State or do against West Virginia. You can do that, particularly if you're playing one of those games, I call them the rent-a-win games. You can do some things subliminally, but you've got to be careful not to introduce the game plan too early because players it just becomes boring to them and they're not as motivated and they're not dealing with it. Practice is about getting them worked at a high pitch to prepare for what they're going to see on Saturday. And if you introduce it too early, you absolutely can peak too early. And I've seen that a lot with really good teams that have just been flat on game day.
And let's point out that, Chris Landry in the position he's in, he will be able to observe practice tape and observe things that, some members of the media won't have access to. So that'll be something valuable here on Tigers Roar and on Pelican Sports Radio because of the position and all the evaluations that you do, not just for LSU, but for a lot of places. You're privy to a little more information than some people.
Well, I think it's always good when you look at practice, you got to really look at the tape and you got to really understand what the purpose is and what they're trying to do in a certain drill. So absolutely getting a chance to look at that is invaluable as a scout to be able to see the growth and development of players and the team itself and exactly what the coaching staff is doing it. So absolutely we look forward to kind of sharing some of that stuff with our viewers here on Tigers Roar and our radio listeners on our Pelican radio show.
Chris, I know this question could be better answered 3, maybe 4 weeks from now, but it's an age-old question that comes out at this time of the year when the players report. How many true freshmen would possibly get on the field at LSU? And again, this can be better answered in 3 or 4 weeks, but there's some guys that I think Coach Miles and his staff are very eager to see if they will, in fact, get on the field as expected.
I think you could have a good 4 or 5 that can be a part of the 2 deep on offense and defense, and then, of course, a good half a dozen more, maybe even 10 more, that can contribute on special teams. I think it's a really good class, really athletic class, and I think it does depend. I don't know that there's a Tyrann Mathieu here that is instinctive and is as mature from a football standpoint. But those guys are the ones that tend to help you early because they're able to ascertain and assimilate a lot of information in a quick period of time and not be just, swimming mentally and confused in days. So I think that the hope is you'll have about 5 or 6 that can contribute in that 2 deep and then several more on special teams. But as you mentioned, That's what you start to determine in the next week or two. Who can you count on? As Parcells used to always tell players, I can't trust you. You know, if you do something wrong, I can't trust you in the game. So you tend to figure out who you can trust, and I don't mean in a bad way. I'm talking about on the football field, in the moment, when the lights are on and they're selling popcorns and taking tickets, who's going to be the one to answer the bell and get it done right? And that's what you have to, as best, figure out as best you can during the practice process.
Well, and you never know, too, when you're going to find one of those diamonds in the rough, right? And I always go back to the story that Jerry Stovall told me when he was head coach at LSU and Dalton Hilliard was a freshman. Mm-hmm. And all the freshmen came into practice, and it was just the freshmen working out, and they'd have their coaches meeting after practice, and the running backs coach was a guy named Darryl Moody.
Mm-hmm.
And Darryl Moody said, Coach Stovall, what about our tailbacks? And Darryl Moody says, after one day of practice, his coach says, the best tailback we got is listed fifth on the depth chart, this Hilliard kid from Patterson. Mm-hmm. Stovall's like, okay, it's one day. Mm-hmm. We just had helmets on. Hey, well, a couple more days of just freshmen practicing. And Moody kept saying, he's the best we got. And Stovall says, well, I waited up. Upperclassmen get in here, we get some pads on, then we'll decide that. Well, the first day that the upperclassmen were there and the pads were on there, that's when Eric Martin became a wide receiver, Herman Fontenot became a wide receiver, because Dalton Hilliard was the best tailback that they had, and it right. was obvious, and probably if we'd have been doing Tigers Roar the day before they reported back in 82, that would have been, then we wouldn't have been saying, oh, look out for the Hilliard kid, because they didn't, it was a diamond in the rough. And obviously, he went on to have an incredible freshman season and then mm-hmm. career, and then, of course, with the New Orleans Saints and all that. So every now and then you get a story.
Absolutely. No, it's a good point you mentioned, is one of the things we'll kind of bring to you, too. Every day you meet, in fact, you meet twice a day during 2 days as a staff. And you have the depth chart on the board, and you literally move guys up and down. Why is that important? It's not for listing, for public consumption. It's done because that determines who gets
the
number
reps.
One reps, the number two reps, and it's really important. If you're not one or two in the depth chart, you're not going to get a significant amount of reps to be able to prove yourself. Well, how do you prove yourself if you're not getting enough reps? Well, the reps that you do get as a third and fourth team guy is going to have to be impressive enough to earn more reps, to work your way up. And that is a perfect illustration of many conversations we've been a big part of. You know what, this guy, special team, this guy's really done something good. Let's move it down. So you'll hear this a lot. Well, so-and-so's moved down the depth chart. It's not anything to just take it with a grain of salt, because it's a process of rewarding someone for earning more reps and wanting to see a little bit more, because it's a little bit of a feeling out process. You don't have, like you do in the NFL, a lot of the OTAs that you can oversee as coaches. So you got to use this time wisely. You're practicing for the next couple of weeks prior to the 29th when you put in your Oregon game plan. You're practicing for the entire season beginning on Thursday until the 28th. And that's really important. You've got to do because if you don't make some important decisions during that time frame, it may result in not being able to get a kid ready to play at some point during the year when you might need him due to injury. So really important time to keep in mind. Not so much of, well, team's looking good or they're going to do it. It's about how they're developing. That's a big part of how you perform into October, November during the football season.
When we come back, we'll get into one of the more popular topics in the last 6 or 7 decades with LSU football. That's the quarterback position. Of course, Jordan Jefferson's the number one guy. He'll take the first snap against Oregon. But we'll talk about the quarterbacks and a few other positions as Chris Landry will give you the insight and the evaluation and the analysis better than anybody else can. So we'll have that when we return. Chris Landry, Tommy Kreisand, you're watching Tigers Roar. Spread the roar on Pelican Sports TV, Baton Rouge, Lafayette, and New Orleans.
Hi, I'm Troy Landry. You're watching Pelican Sports TV. I'm fixing to shoot him. Shoot him.
Hello, my name is Debbie. Welcome to Debbie's Bridal, a formal affair.
Come see the many great lines we carry in bridal. Bridesmaids, mothers, flower girls, tuxes, and more. We also carry over 25 top designer lines in debutante gowns, Mardi Gras, pageant, and prom. Come meet me and my staff with over 30 years of bridal and pageant experience. Debbie's Bridal, a formal affair, Burnside and Gonzales, where service matters.
Creel Tree Service is a licensed and insured tree service providing tree and stump removal, topping, trimming, cabling, pruning, and fertilizing. We have free stump removal with takedowns, free estimates, affordable rates, and senior citizens discounts. Call 774-TREE. That's 774-8733. Get your yard ready for the warmer weather. If it deals with a tree, call me, Creel Tree Service. 774-8733. That's 774-TREE.
Lady, you shouldn't be here.
Oh, I'm not here. I'm just a figment of your imagination. But you are thinking about grabbing a Rocky Mountain cold Coors Light at happy hour. Maybe you can even buy me one.
You're gorgeous. What's your name?
Jim. And thanks.
Keep it up, Jimbo.
Frost Brewed Coors Light, the world's most refreshing beer.
When you go hunting for tires, be sure to go to Hunt's Tire and Car Care, established in 1988. Hunt's Tire offers complete car care services and can meet all of your tire needs. From north to south, east to west, come see less for the best. Michelin tires and great service. Call 272-7404. Relax in the customer lounge while waiting for your vehicle. Serving the greater Baton Rouge area since 1988, Hunt's Tire and Car Care is ready to serve you.
Explore the charms of the North Shore and visit St. Tammany Parish. Whether you're looking for a cultural experience or an adventure, you'll find it here. Enjoy great attractions and fantastic dining in a relaxed and friendly atmosphere.
Come visit us and discover the history and heritage that is Louisiana's North Shore.
For more information, log on to louisiananorthshore.com/bb.
Continue with Tigers Roar. Many weeks during the course of Tigers Roar at this point in time on the show, we're joined by Brian Lazar of TigerBait.com. And Brian unable to join us in this week's edition. Hopefully we have him next week. Chris Landry, Tommy Chrysan with you. Chris, the LSU quarterback position, it's always talked about, with the backup's the favorite guy in the stadium and all this, that, and the other. We know all the cliches. But going into this 2011 football season, fifth-year senior Jordan Jefferson, he's the guy. He's got the keys to the car, however you want to put it. And people are expecting a lot out of him. I'm sure Jordan is expecting a lot out of himself. You know, building off of his performance against A&M, which was clearly his best game front to end last year. But he's going to be the guy against Oregon.
Well, no question about it. He's going to be against Oregon and beyond. I think that, you know, one thing I think that everyone probably needs to understand is that Les Miles has always been a coach that believes in experience and playing guys that have the most experience. And right now it's Jordan Jefferson and it's Jarrett Lee number two. So while I think it's going to, the interesting story may be, how quickly can Zach Mettenberger, if at all, get to the number two spot? Because that number two position, as you mentioned, the number two quarterback, most popular in town anyway. But, you know, I think the quarterback position is one, as we look at the list of quarterbacks, that, you know, you're somewhat limited by what your quarterback can do. And then I think your playmaking ability from the quarterback position can take you to the next level. I don't need to remind everybody what tremendous quarterback play that Auburn got and what it led for their team. I think in other cases where, let's say Alabama, where in a couple of years ago, winning the national championship prior to that, had good, heady decision-making from Greg McElroy, who got his team in the right play in the right formation. So it's first important to identify what you have, what his skill sets are, and utilize those to his strength and kind of marginalize, if you can, his weaknesses. I think the strength of Jordan, as we kind of take a look at it, is just this: his movement skills. When he can get out on the edge, his ability to throw it and run is really the best thing that he does, because it, first of all, it gives him half-field reads, it gets the ball out of his hands quicker, And then it also gives a run threat that the defense has to honor. And it allows, you know, it forces defenders to peel off coverage. Now, I really think where he struggles is when he is in a deep set in the pocket and he's got to go through his read progressions. You want the ball out of his hands quicker. I know that from a technique standpoint, Steve Craigthorpe has worked very hard in getting that improved. But I think anyone that expects him to have a dynamic change and epiphany and be a different type of quarterback, I think is mistaken. What I think is you have to take the same quarterback, which I think is slightly improved, and accentuate more of what he does well. It's just as simple as that. And I think he can keep drives alive with his feet. I think you can help him by getting him on the edge and creating that run-pass option more. And what we talked about a lot last year on Tiger's Roar during the season is, I think, take some more chances on early downs. When you get teams honoring your very successful and potent running game, take some chances against eight-man fronts where you're going to have reduced guys in coverage and you get some opportunities to make some plays. That's going to only help your ability to run it more effectively. So that's going to be the key there. Now, if you have to go to your next quarterback, the guy that they would go to at this early stage is the guy that just made that throw, Jarrett Lee. He is a guy that, because he's had experience playing at the SEC level, certainly had a positive effect on them winning a couple of games, and certainly comes to mind is the Florida game. He is an effective relief pitcher is what I look at Jarrett Lee. I think he lacks the consistency and struggles versus pressure. He doesn't see the field all that well, and I think the more he plays, the more he's a little bit exposed in those areas. But he is a streaky. You know, I think he's a relief pitcher. I think that's what he is. You make him go seven innings, Tommy, you know that. That's not what they do. I think they're a better fit when they can kind of see things, get a feel for things on the sidelines in the game plan, and then come in a stretch role. Now, what fans sometimes see is they see the snapshot, the highlight pitcher, and think that, well, if you take that and elongate that, you're going to get that all the time. Well, it doesn't happen that way in most cases, or else he would be starting. But I think they feel good about the fact that they've got experience at the number one and two position. Now, how good are the quarterbacks? I think they're pretty average, quite frankly. I think that the rest of the team, the defense and special teams, which we'll get into at a later point, are going to have to carry them like they did last year. And the running game is going to have to be the focal point of the offense. But doesn't mean they have to run it more. It just means that when they run it, when they throw it, it's going to be pivotal for this offensive team's success. Zach Mettenberger, who's the apple of everybody's eyes, pure and simple, at this stage, through his time that he's been on campus, pure and simple, is not ready to play SEC ball right now. In a month or so, will he be a little bit closer? Hopefully that gap will get to the point where if they have to play him or need to turn to him, just because he can throw a nice ball doesn't mean he knows where to throw it, doesn't mean he understands the offense well enough to be able to direct everything. So that's kind of how that offense, from a quarterback standpoint, shapes up. Steven Rivers is going to be a redshirt guy. He's strictly a developmental guy that's going to absorb as a sponge, work scout team. Gerard Randall, who is the kid that initially went to Oregon, is a super athlete. I think it's going to be really an important factor on scout team. When they get ready to play an athletic team with an athletic quarterback like Oregon, Gerard's going to be a big part of being able to run that opposing offense to give it the defense a look.
And, of course, Jared Foster, who's from Barb High School in Lake Charles, Coach Jimmy Shaver, a great job with that program over there. He's obviously a practice guy.
Another scout team guy.
Looking down the road.
Absolutely.
As to whether or not he could do anything. Jared Lee's the number two guy. I would suspect that you should not be surprised if he gets into the Oregon game. He may not. I mean, Jefferson may take every snap. But the coaches may feel there's a spot to put Lee in. We'll have to wait and see on that. I want to echo and elaborate on a point that you made. You know, Jordan Jefferson's not going to become this, you know, 100% new and improved guy, as you've described. But the key will be, as you also described, let him do what he does best. That's get out of that pocket, get on a move, have his feet as a threat, and he throws the ball better when he's on the move. So and I'm sure Coach Craigthorpe and Coach Miles are aware of all that, and they will, you know, you don't want to, You know, you don't ask in basketball, you don't ask a guy to shoot 3-point shots if he can't shoot. Well, you don't want to ask Jordan Jefferson to, you know, sit in the pocket with a 5 or 7 step drop all day and you know, and read, find a guy open. He's better at the other, and I think the coaches will do that.
Well, people point, well, he played very well against Texas A&M. Well, he also did some good things against Alabama as well. I think, though, the difference was how they utilized him, and I think the timing in the game, particularly as it related to Alabama, with the game being a little bit more in doubt, it forced the hand to be a little bit more aggressive from a coaching standpoint, and that takes some chances on early downs where Jordan had success. So I think there's some things you can do to help him. I don't think he's going to be a different quarterback, but I think the production could be quite a bit better. Here's one thing that will be different. I can tell you this, and we'll get into this, I know, on Thursday when I do my football show and break down the coaches. You know, Steve Craigthorpe, let's go back with Gary Croton. Gary Croton was a very cerebral coach, but, you know, a guy in his mid-60s, a Mormon, very, you know, when Les Miles wanted to do something, he didn't push it because he's the head coach. You know, Steve Craigthorpe can and will get into a player's face, a coach's face. He's going to want this offense to be more productive because he has aspirations beyond just being the offensive coordinator here. So, you know, you hear this a lot about, well, they're going to be more on the same page. Now, they're going to do – the difference is going to be you've got a coordinator that wants his side of the ball. He's going to fight for his side of the ball to be more successful and is not going to want to have some of the things that have happened here in the past. So that could get real interesting, of course, because that's where Les Miles, his philosophy is more along the lines of, I'm not going to take any risks in a game where I feel I've got better personnel. I'm only going to take some chances when I need to, and that's why they tend to somewhat play down to the level of their competition. But it's effective in that they win a lot of close games in the end because of the fact that they have superior personnel in most cases, and they're able to pull it out.
When we come back, we're going to talk about running backs, the always a key position, and LSU's got a stable of them. They've got some good ones. They got a bunch of them that'll get some carries this year, and then maybe one will separate themselves. But when we come back, Chris Landry will take a look at running backs for you. I'm Tommy Chrysan. This is Tigers Roar, Spread the Roar, Wednesday nights at 8 o'clock on Pelican Sports TV.
I am Glenn Big Baby Davis, and you're watching Pelican Sports Television.
With a combined staff of over 250 years of experience, the Bug Man has the upper hand on bugs.
Call us today about pest control solutions for your home.
Call 923-BUGS.
And rest easy in a pest-free environment.
Follow the Bug Man's plan.
When you need to hire, you need to know about Better Baton Rouge Jobs, Better Acadiana Jobs, and NewOrleansJobsList.com. We have a faster, more affordable way to find and hire employees. Now you can save even more with this special offer from Pelican Sports TV. Post your job listings on any of these sites and use promo code PELICAN10 to save an additional 10%. Find qualified applicants and save money, too, with promo code PELICAN10. And remember, we're free for job seekers and great for Louisiana business.
Either you can say real meat or you can't. And at Papa John's, the reason we call our sausage is because it's 100% real meat. Nobody does what Papa John's does.
Introducing Papa's Summer Special. For just $10, get a large spicy Italian specialty pizza loaded with pepperoni and double the spicy sausage. Or get any large pizza with your choice of toppings, even specialties, only $11. Order now at the new PapaJohns.com.
Better ingredients, better pizza. Papa John's.
Pelican Sports TV presents Pelican Radio. Get ready to mix it up with me, Tommy Chrysan, and Chris Landry weekday afternoons from 3 to 4 p.m. Pro sports, college sports, high school sports, and much more on The Score 1210 a.m. and on the internet at thescore1210.com.
For the thirsty, for those who hang out in packs, for heroes, for sidekicks, for those who see the glass half empty, for those who see it half full, for those on the right, for those on the left, for those with nicknames, for those with curves, for people that cycle, for people that recycle, for BFFs, for frenemies, for those with style, for lovers, for families, for big families, for everyone.
Follow the Bug Man's plan.
Rest easy in a pest-free environment.
With mosquito misting systems, Centricon termite baiting, infrared camera inspections, and the Bug Man's famous Pest Plus program, the Bug Man has the upper hand on bugs. Call 923-BUGS.
We continue with Tigers Roar here on Pelican Sports TV, continuing to look at position breakdowns as we'll do through the course of August, getting you ready for September 3rd when LSU plays Oregon in Arlington. 7 o'clock kickoff, ABC TV. Let's talk running back position, and they've got some good ones. Spencer Ware, a little number change there. Michael Ford, Alfred Blue, the three guys with the most experience carrying the ball, although Ford's carries were a little bit limited. But I think this coaching staff likes where they're at in the running back position.
Well, they're deep. The best playmaker on offense is Spencer Ware. I think he has tremendous ability. I think he's big, physical, aggressive style runner with a burst. I like his body control and balance. I think he shows ability in the passing game. I think he has special qualities. I think he can be the feature back, and also think he could do some things on third downs that could really help you and can be a real asset in the short passing game with run after catch yardage. So I think he's got special qualities. Alfred Blue is a guy that would be running second, and he's a smooth, natural one-cut runner that attacks downhill. He's that downhill runner much in the Stephen Ridley mold. He's a little bit narrow-based. And not quite as nifty as Steven was from a foot quickness standpoint, but he's an effective downhill runner and a compliment to Spencer Ware. Michael Ford, I think, is another back with a good combination of power, quickness, change of direction. He runs under his pads very well, good balance, but he's more of a one-gear power back, and that's the difference. And you know, the issue is why he's been running third, where it separates him from the other backs, and where he's got to improve upon is his run instincts are not natural, not ideal, and his struggles with blocking assignments, particularly on third down. So it's a little bit of a liability having him in there at that point. I think a guy to look out for is Ja'Kerry Gore. He has a role as a change of pace runner in this offense, I do believe. He's an ideal slot back, not a slot receiver, but a slot back, wing back set. He's got outstanding quickness, change of direction, pass receiving skills are outstanding. I think he can be a much needed release option for a quarterback that's you know, going to need some help in the passing game. Remember, you know, take those short passes and make something out of them that could really help and spur your offense. So I think that's going to be a key. Kenny Heard is a guy that may get some work in kind of that backup role as a young back. He's a big guy, not a lot of niftiness to him, but he's a big back that has the size and power that we'll see how he can handle his weight throughout the course of the season, and certainly see what can happen there. So, you know, Terrence McGee is another guy that has
somebody
some ability.
I'm looking forward to seeing Terrence McGee
in a couple of different spots, but I do think that running back, he has a real chance to help early. He's got some real quickness, some, you know, playing the quarterback in high school, being a great runner. I think he has those run instincts that are a little natural. You know, you like backs with a combination of size and power and speed, but really what separates those type of backs between them and special backs are ones with great run instincts, the vision to be able to see the field, hit the hole hard, and decisively. And this young man has some ability to be a very, very good running back and possibly contribute early.
I saw a lot of high school tape on Terrence McGee, and of course he led the Franklin Demons to the state championship. Coach Sean Smith has really built that program up in Washington Parish, and we talked earlier about true freshmen that may get on the field. This is a guy who could be on that list when we get to September.
Absolutely, there's no question, health permitting, I think he will be. And in addition to those run instincts, he does have the speed to bounce it outside. When he hits the corner, he can get upfield in a hurry. So I think he has a chance to really help. And I think from a run skill standpoint and run vision standpoint, he may be second only to Spencer Ware.
And then in the fullback position, which at LSU is more of a block, pickup blitz kind of position.
Yeah, James Stampley, of course, I formation, lead fullback type, very limited run skills. But he's a big boy that, 230, 235 pounds. He's a really good lead blocker.
He can get a linebacker out of the hole.
Absolutely, sure can. And with their physical jumbo sets, he's a big part of it. J.C. Copeland is even bigger. He's in that 268, 272 pound range. So he's a guy that will see a lot of time. Kellen Terrio is a guy that's battled a lot of injuries, but he's got some ability as well to play fullback. And of course, Cleveland Davis, Connor Neighbors are more of a scout team type guys that are going to be fighting for playing times, but can be real factors on special teams, particularly on playing up back and playing on kickoff and field goal teams.
A position that does have a question mark by it in preseason evaluation, wide receiver. Of course, Reuben Randall has had his moments and has shown some tremendous potential. Russell Shepard, as Chris reported earlier, is expected to be at practice in spite of the compliance issues that surfaced several weeks ago. But Reuben Randall, Shepard, and perhaps Jared Fobbs will be expected to be the go-to guys as wide receivers.
Well, Reuben is certainly going to have to step up. He is the most talented of the receiver. He plays the X position, the split end position, and he's got great stride. He's got great fluidity. He's got good strength. He's got to become more consistent. I think that's the thing that separates him from being a good one to potentially a really good or great one. Consistency. What does consistency mean? Well, consistency in running routes like you're supposed to, being where you're supposed to be, consistency in diagnosing what the defense is doing against you, and consistency catching the football. I think those things are going to determine whether he can be elite or just be a guy that's a good one that has his moments. I think Russell Shepard certainly is pivotal. You've heard that name for some time now. Seems like he's been here a long time, and he has been here for a little bit. He's got to become more of a factor. He is not the natural hand catcher that I think they thought he might be when they switched him over. He's going to have to be more effective in the slot. I think he can run that route well. I think he can run the slip screens. I think that he can be effective as a runner after the catch. I think he can be effective on reverses. I think he's much more effective when he runs routes that face towards the quarterback where he can cradle the ball because, again, he doesn't have natural hands. But his availability, if there's no issues and that is completely cleared, is going to be important. Certainly his health is going to be important. Then you get into, and I think it's a fair point to question, who's going to step up? I mean, you're going to roll your coverage away to Reuben Randall. Certainly D'Angelo Peterson as the tight end in a Y-flex position is going to be a big part of this offense as it relates to the passing game. But Russell Shepard's got to step up. Who else is going to step up? You're going to roll your coverage one way. Somebody must be able to take advantage of that. I think Kadron Boone is the best blocker of the receivers on the team, which is really an asset in the running game. You've got to be able to knock that safety on his rear end, and he can do that very well. Strong, he's physical. I think he's a quicker than fast guy. He's not a guy that's going to get open against really top-notch defenders. He's a guy that's going to have to get open by scheme, by design. It does have good hands and can be very effective. I think James Wright is much the same in that he's got good quickness, decent speed. He's a long arm, long strider guy that's more of a build-up speed guy, but I like his ball skills. He's a guy, though, that's going to have to compete for the ball in coverage because he doesn't have great separation quickness. But you can get him open with a lot of screens, with a lot of designs you're going to have to do that. Because I think both Boone and Wright can be effective. You mentioned Jarrett Fobbs. He certainly has the most speed and quickness and overall playmaking ability after the catch of the receivers on this team. He's quick in and out of his cuts. But there again, consistency, catching the football and running routes are the key with him. So who's going to step up? Armond Williams, no question that Jarvis Landry, I thought, had a chance with his hands and his savviness as a route runner and ball skills to be a contributor early. The injury, unfortunate as it was, is going to hurt his ability, retard that progress of development. So we'll see if he can help much at all. I think Odell Beckham can be effective as a slot, as a return guy. He's got great make-you-miss ability. So you're going to have some guys step up here, because if you look at the passing game of LSU, you got questions at quarterback, and you wonder what the production level is going to be at receiver. At the end of the year, we're looking at the success of this offense, and the success or lack thereof is going to be tied to the quarterback and the receiver play, because the running back and offensive line is very, very consistent and solid.
Quickly, some recruiting notes.
Well, a couple of things I want to bring. Patrick Miller, an offensive tackle from Dyer High School at West Palm Beach, Florida. Good-looking kid, Tommy. 6'7", 260. Spent some time recently at LSU's camp. Looked at some film on him. He's got to fill out and get stronger. But, boy, does he have a chance to be a really good player. Really narrowed it down at this point to Auburn and LSU. So we'll see how that plays out. And Dwayne Stanford. He is a receiver from Taft High School in Cincinnati area. He is a top player in the state of Ohio, one of the top receivers in the country. LSU's looking to add another big receiver to their 2012 class. He's a good-looking kid, good basketball player as well. In fact, as a sophomore, he played against Princeton High School and played against somebody by the name of Spencer Ware. Anyway, this kid's really athletic, good ball skills. He has an interest looking at other schools, Alabama, Miami, but LSU is in his top three. We'll see how that develops.
Chris, tell everybody a little hint of what they're going to get on the Chris Landry Show Thursday, 2 o'clock on the Score 1210 AM in Baton Rouge, online to score1210.com.
We'll break down in the breakdown segment. We'll look at LSU special teams. We'll look at LSU's coaching staff, their roles and their skill sets there, and how that may play out this year. In football 101, we're going to take you through the wide receiver reads, how they go about that process. In the football scoop segment, we're going to talk to you a little bit about some of the off-the-radar college football teams that might have a better season than you might anticipate. And you don't want to miss the rest of the story. It's going to be the story of the one that got away from me and from LSU and is making his way to the Hall of Fame, Pro Football Hall of Fame, this weekend.
And, of course, Pelican Sports Radio, Monday through Friday from 3 until 4 p.m. Same station, the Score 1210 a.m. online at thescore1210.com. Podcasts are available of both the Chris Landry Show and Pelican Sports Radio by going to thescore1210.com. Click the on-demand button, click Pelican Sports Radio, and it's all in there by segments with the date of the show that it did occur. And, of course, Chris's show every Thursday, which will also be available now in New Orleans at 6 p.m. on a Friday on WIST, 690 a.m., 104.9 FM. Sports Radio in New Orleans will play a replay of the Chris Landry Show Fridays at 6 p.m. So we do want you to spread the word on that. And, of course, spread the roar about Tigers Roar every Wednesday night, 8 o'clock, two full hours for you. I mean, we're going to have interviews. They're going to have clips, highlights. We're going to have special features, phone calls, guests from time to time. It's going to be some really good stuff. It streams online at PelicanSportsTV.com. So do want you to go ahead and check that out. I want to thank the entire crew of Pelican Sports TV. Again, this is show number 50. And a lot of people involved with getting this thing done for you. Chris Landry, NFL scout, Fox Sports football analyst. I'm Tommy Chrysan. Spread the roar. Tigers Roar on Pelican Sports TV, Baton Rouge, Lafayette, and New Orleans.
Hello, my name is Debbie. Welcome to Debbie's Bridal, a formal affair.
Come see the many great lines we carry in bridal. Bridesmaids, mothers, flower girls, tuxes, and more. We also carry over 25 top designer lines in debutante gowns, Mardi Gras, pageant, and prom. Come meet me and my staff with over 30 years of bridal and pageant experience. Debbie's Bridal, a formal affair, Burnside and Gonzales, where service matters.
Either you can say real meat or you can't. And at Papa John's, the reason we call our sausage is because it's 100% real meat. Nobody does what Papa John's does.
Introducing Papa's Summer Special. For just $10, get a large spicy Italian specialty pizza loaded with pepperoni and double the spicy sausage. Or get any large pizza with your choice of toppings, even specialties, only $11. Order now at the new PapaJohns.com.
Better ingredients, better pizza, Papa John's.
on the same flight.
We'll be on the same plane regardless.
Yeah, what was your work? Anything together? Do we know that?
Got it.
Thanks, Dave.
The big, brilliant, thin Samsung Infuse 4G. Only from the network of possibilities, AT&T.